José Principe, that's from the
University of Florida.
So I know Dr. Principe for a long time, maybe more than 20 years. We collaborated together when I was at the University of Florida too. Some statistics make him look good. PhD graduates, 67 master's students graduated over a few years, 250 publications, H index 67, fellow in a couple of societies, big ones, IEEE in particular and AIME, editor-in-chief of a couple of IEEE journals, and lately the past editor of the transactions of the biomedical engineering, and lately the IEEE reviews on biomedical engineering. Many, many distinctions that Dr. Prince told me not to mention. And he's active, very active in brain research in Singapore for a long time. And especially, it's from what our discussions here, we discovered that he is actually active in, more active than before. So he's at the top of his career at this point. Right. So I would like to welcome, let's all welcome Dr. Principe. He's top to be on the somatosensory brain machine interface.
Okay. Yeah, you know, life is an integrator. So I started, you know, I still remember starting writing my first paper, right? And now I have so many that I don't count anymore. So, and this happens because I've been fortunate to work with brilliant students. Shoulders, there's a lot of responsibility. All right? So I like to start by saying this because most students think that the professors know everything. Right? It is true, we know a lot, but there are problems we cannot solve without you, and there are problems that cannot be solved in my generation, and so it will be your generation that needs to continue. Okay? So this is just to put some
perspective.
Yes, some weight on your shoulders. And the topic that I selected today is some research that I've been doing for the last, 15, 16 years. Started early with my interest in EEG analysis, but the brain-machine interfaces is something that I started working in 2000 with Professor Miguel Nicolelis. And I'm going to give you an overview of all this challenges of the opportunities that we still have in brain-machine interfaces. And as everything, I think we need to, when we start, we are engineers, and so the first thing that we have to do is define what is a brain-machine interface, right? So I'm sure that all of you have an idea, but I think it's important to start with the definition. This definition is, I think, still applies to that. Field is evolving so fast that there may be some of the parts of the field that, you know, are beyond what I say. But I still think that the idea is that the brain-machine interface is a man-made device that either substitutes an input to the brain, repairs functional communication between brain areas, or translates intention of movement. Okay? So you see the brain. And then, basically, brain-machine interface is a device that we build that is able to cause of disease or accident, the brain may not receive the information from a certain sensory organ, for instance, ear, or eye. And so one brain-machine interface could be, you know, a cochlear implant. Likewise, if the brain loses communication with the body, with the spinal cord, then the brain tries to move, you know, the arm of the body, but nothing happens. Right. So this is exactly, so there is a need then to translate intention of movement to a robotic device or to an exoskeleton that effectively will implement that movement that the person wants.
Okay.
So this is really what I consider to be the three basic areas of brain-machine interfaces. And I also like to tell you that only multidisciplinary research effectively will be able to build the dream of having a brain-machine interface usable for real-world applications. And so there is close work between engineering, neurophysiology, and computational neuroscience that can realize this dream. So this is an evolving field, very interesting. But we are giving the first steps. And the question that I always think is important to answer is, how did we get here? It's an important question, you know, because this gives us the historical perspective. And so I'm going to briefly go through the historical perspective. And where did I start? Well, I decided to start this time on a British neurosurgeon, called Alfred Smee, that lived in the 1818 to 1877. This was a very important time because Maxwell's equations were invented at the time. So it was the beginning of electricity. But Alfred Smee was a neurosurgeon. And he wrote in 1850 a book called Electrobiology. And in one of the figures in the book, he has this figure that to me is the first embodiment of the action perception cycle, and if you will, also those of you that know neural networks, the first embodiment of a neural network, that is basically what the brain is. You know, so this is the brain, and if you notice, the brain communicates with the muscles and receives information from the skin, you know, from the ears, from the eyes, and of course, between the muscle and the sensors of the body lies reality, the world, outside world. Right? So he already understood that the brain to work with the world, that means all interaction with the world, comes from a cycle that involves action, perception, and processing of information. So this is, I think, it's an amazing picture when we think that this was done, you know, in the 19th century. And the guy even went further, gave a definition that I consider the most clear definition of consciousness in this book, Human Mind. And notice the voltaic mechanism of man, so we see the electricity, the explosion of the interest in electricity. But look at what we define as consciousness. When an image is produced by an action upon the external senses, the actions on the organs of sense concur with the actions in the brain. And the image is then real. However, when an image occurs to the mind without the corresponding simultaneous action of the body, it's called. And then, the third point is the one that is amazing. The power of distinguishing between the thought and reality is consciousness. Okay, so I think that this tells you that in the 19th century, there was already a lot of interesting ideas about the role of the brain, the relations with the mind, you know, and how this very complicated system that we have over our shoulders actually works. Of course, the first measurements, that all of this was philosophy, right? It was analysis and thinking. The first measurements on the brain were done by Hans Berger in the turn of the century. And he was really the inventor of the electroencephalograph. And so the first measurements of brain activity were done exactly at the turn of the century, at the 19th to 20th century. And it turns out that this is why is this important for this talk? Because, you know, humans build tools. But our relationship with tools have always been kind of master-slave. I build a tool that I need for some goal, right? And it has been like this since, you know, the first era until, you know, the toys that we have today, right? For transportation. And so I think this is important that there is this master-slave relationship between ourselves and the tools that we build. And this is the reason why, for instance, now there is a big commotion about can robots that we build become more important than, you know, maybe the masters. So there's a lot of, in the popular press, and not only in popular press, there is lots of discussions on this. But I think that this tells you a little bit about how we started, okay, and even most of the things that we do, the technology that we build today, is we are still the masters, right? Who drives a car? Still us, maybe the next generation, maybe a computer. But this is a very important thing. But the first time that you had a machine that made decisions by itself was, in my view, the anti-aircraft fire control in 1941, during the war. So this machine, this is a big problem, right? Because you have a machine gun, you know, you have a plane flying in the sky at high speed. How are you going to shoot the plane, right? And in fact, you know, there was statistics that said for every 100,000 bullets, you shoot one plane. Well, that's not very efficient, huh? But of course, you still need to shoot planes, you know. But so that was the big issue. Can we devise a machine that can predict the position of the plane automatically and then point the gun to that point in space that the plane is going to be in the future? This was exactly the first computer algorithm that was running in real time in vacuum tubes, things that you guys probably never heard before or never saw. If you go to a science museum, you probably saw the vacuum tubes. But this was implemented in analog electronics, this system. Okay. And the name, this name is a very famous name in mathematicians, Norbert Wiener. And this was the poor engineer that had to do the work, right? This guy wrote the equations. This guy had to think of a way of implementing those equations in analog electronics. After the war, there was a set of 11 meetings that were sponsored by the Macy Foundation between 1946 and that they brought together a set of multidisciplinary people that has never before in the history of science, at least that's what they claim. Because you had mathematicians, you had, you know, in fact, technologists. Von Neumann was also a mathematician, but he also was the inventor of the first digital computer. You know, you had prominent neuroscientists like, you know, look, that in fact was the chair of this meeting. And you had engineers like Pete, you know, Lodgen attended, one of the later you know, meetings, and you also had a very prominent psychologist like me. And the ideas here were to bring together some teachings from living organisms and the new ideas of algorithms and communication systems and control systems that were being developed, that had been developed during the war, exactly to make them use for the human society. And the focus was really very much associated with things that we still use today, information. All the technology revolution that came from communications is based on optimal use of information. That was exactly, you know, Shannon, he was the father of these ideas. That is the feedback, you know, for control. And the Wiener, that he thought that in fact, one of the big figures in this group was Norbert Wiener, because he really believed that behavior could be explained by mathematical principles. Came up with this idea of cybernetics. This is the book cover of the book that was published by him. And the idea that he had this cycle of sensing, comparing goals with, you know, acting and sensing again. So you see this the cycle that we see, the action perception cycle that he saw in biology. You think he could mathematize this cycle? Of course, we all think that robots were something that the 21st century, but in fact, there was the first autonomous robot was built in 1950 by a guy called Gray Walton in England. He had this device that he called the tortoise, you know, with vacuum tubes, right? A lot of vacuum tubes here, you know, because this robot had motors and would roam the environment, but also had a solar cell. And then when you put the sensor in the solar cell, of course, when the solar cell, you know, the battery, the sensor in the battery, so the solar cell will be, you know, charging the battery, but when you put the sensor in the battery, then the system was programmed to go to the light. This is the first embodiment of an autonomous robot. And in fact, he then wrote a book where he presented 7 postulates for autonomous behavior. So you see that all these things, and this is a lesson for all of us, is when you have an idea, we use the technology to fulfill the idea, not the opposite. We have to have ideas. Technology helps us fulfill. Okay. Anyway, so I'm going to be very, very brief because von Neumann was the guy that I'm sure those of you that have a computer science background, you know that this fellow was able for the first time to create an electronic device that implemented the Turing machine. And this is the basis of computers that we still use today. Okay. But look at the quote from 1951. A new essential logic theory is called for in order to understand the highly complexity of automata and in particular the central nervous system. He was already telling us that logic is not, the way we use it is not sufficient. It might be, however, that in the process, logic will have to undergo a pseudomorphosis to neurology to a much greater extent than the reverse. So you think that we have to improve our tools, mathematical tools, to effectively understand biology. This guy is also not very well known, but I think it's very important because in this 1960 paper, he postulated the man-computer symbiosis, and that's exactly what we have. So the web is exactly, you know, this guy in 1960 was exactly saying that brains and computing machines are going to be tightly. So this is just to give you the background to see where we are today. And of course, Marvin Minsky is a scientist that was the father of AI, you know, with the expert systems. And then this starts the talk, basically. Because John Chapin, in 1999, was able to show for the first time in the Nature Neuroscience paper that rats could control their feeding directly from brainwaves. So what he did, he implemented the first motor brain machine interface, because he put electrodes in the motor cortex of rats, and with that information, you know, that information was decoded such that, you know, a lever would be pressed and the animal would have access to food. So this really starts the field of brain machine interfaces, you know, in 1999. Okay? I had the opportunity of working with John Chapin and Miguel Nicolalis in the first large DARPA grant that created the brain machine interface.
How big was the grant?
$23 million. So it was a lot of money for 5 years. But it was a very big group also. But this was the first large investment in brain machine interface technology. Anyway, so let's now go a little deeper into what are the ingredients to build a brain machine interface. Okay, so you see that we have to link somehow brains with machines, with computers, right? And so one important thing that is called in brain machine interface decoding is how do you get brain activity that is building the substrate for an intention and translate it into an action in a computer. This is called decoding. All right? So it goes from the brain to the machine. And the other one that is called encoding is the opposite. So there is a stimulus in the external world that needs to be converted into a percept in the brain. Okay, so this is called encoding. And so the technology that are able to actually implement decoding and encoding is really what is a brain machine interface. Okay? And in order to be efficient in implementing these operations, we need to understand how the brain processes information. So this is where the multidisciplinarity comes in. We engineers can build, you know, the physical systems, the physical embodiments for decoding and decoding. We can also implement in using computer algorithms these functions, but we need to know what functions. That is really, we have to learn that part from our colleagues in the computer scientists. The cognitive and the computational neuroscientists. Okay? So, now if I look at when you place electrodes in the brain, you know, how is the information received? Okay? Of course, the brain cells called the neurons communicate among themselves. And they communicate in terms of action potentials. Basically, an action potential is a waveform that basically always has the same shape. And so the only information carried by an action potential that is normally also called a spike is the time when it occurs. Okay? And so this is the reason why there are methods that work with the timing information of action potentials and spikes. But there is other ways that we can think about it. And these ways were mostly, discovered in the motor side, when the motor neurons communicate with muscles. Because scientists verified that when there was a burst of spikes that we call the rate. That means the number of spikes divided by time gives us a rate. So the rate was also very important to, for instance, in the musculature, in the muscles, you know, to move the arm, and was proportional to the angle of the movement and the speed of the movement. So those are the two types of where the information lies, is in the spikes and in the rate. But and this also kind of quantifies exactly the type of mathematical models that we have to use to effectively design these algorithms. If I'm interested in spike timing, I have to use point process models that are more advanced statistical tests. But if I use rates, I can use signal processing technology, you know, to effectively implement models. Okay, so those of you, I'm sure that most of you are able to work with rates, like, you know, you can do FFTs, you know, you can do, you know, because rates are integers, you know, so they are numbers, you know, so we can use neural networks or other technologies to extract the spike intervals require point processes. So this is more advanced technologies, you know, in mathematics, because you have to use point processes. And I'm going to briefly take the okay. So what are the enablers? I think I already mentioned this, but I think that the neuroscience knowledge and paradigms is very important. We also need to collect information from as many neurons as possible, right? This is the role of the engineers, microelectrode arrays and electromagnetics. Of course, when we do this, we place these electrodes in the brain, you know, we have to make sure that they are biocompatible. Otherwise, you know, the brain, the tissue will reject these devices. And of course, then we would like to do this with low power and implant it inside the you know, under the skull. So we need miniaturization for electrodes and electronics. Okay. And of course, on top of all this, we have to design our algorithms of decoding and encoding to effectively implement the function. Okay. And so this really also is changing the way we engineers are building our models. And so I think that this is the enablers that I think. And I'm going to briefly tell you some of the things for those of you that don't know. This is an example of an electrode array with tungsten electrodes. This is a dime, I think, or maybe a cent. And this is just to tell you, you know, so those are each one of these electrodes is about 3 millimeters or 2 millimeters of length and 250 micron separation, and they are very, very thin. And this, the impedance is between 100K to 1.5 megaohms. And so these things you can include, you can implant in brain tissue. Since they are short, this normally gives you only access to the cortex. The cortex is a layer that involves the paleo brain. That is about 3 millimeters thick. And so this really only collects from the cortex. Of course, if we want to build devices, and this is one of the devices that my lab worked on, we have to pack everything, because now we not only have to have multiple electrode arrays that should be in flexible cables such that we can that the brain kind of moves while we are walking. And so we need to have the flexible cabling. We also would like to transmit the information out, right? And of course, we also have to do this such that, you know, this is actually, you know, very tiny. This is an example of a rat skull, and the idea is to put the electrode, you know, on top of the skull. And of course, all of this has to be powered by batteries, by, you know, because they are electronic circuits. And the electronic circuits will have to amplify the signals, and then implement in real time the computational algorithms. So you see that this is really a very sophisticated piece of technology. Then, you know, we also can design, and this is an example, this is the first real-time brain-machine interface was designed in my lab at the University of Florida, and we were using 100 channels of spike data that was collected from a monkey, and the computer was controlling exactly the joystick. You know, the main monkeys are playing video games on the computer. And they were, and when they are successful, because we had the video game target, and we had to move the pointer to the target. When they moved the pointer to the target, we would feed the animals some orange juice that they love, you know. And so they were engaged in this game and learning, you know. And what is interesting is once they master the communication, you know, they realized that they were not moving their hands, and then they were just, you know, couch potatoes like we are, you know, watching TV, we don't move, right? And the monkeys is exactly the same thing. Once they master this, they would be sitting still in the cage, you know, in the seat, and getting juice from, you know, while playing the game. So it was a very interesting thing. Anyway. So this type of brain-machine interfaces that I'm discussing, I consider them the first generation, and this is the block diagram of the algorithm. So we are collecting data from the brain of the animal, and we are, for instance, we must know in space where is the limb of the animal, or the head, and then we feed this information from the neural signal processing to a DSP algorithm. So this teaches this algorithm, adaptive algorithm, how to translate neural signals in positions of the link in 3D space. And this is really the implementation of the Martin's lab concept, right? So the brain is doing everything, you know, this DSP algorithm is a slave, right? Because you bring to the algorithm exactly the desired response. You also bring the input, so the only thing that the DSP algorithm does is just match the two as much as possible. So supervised learning is nothing but a master-slave concept. This is the type of tasks that we use. I'm going to show you some data, so I need to briefly discuss. This is a 3D task where the animal, you know, is put some food. You know, and then he has to, when the buzzer, you know, goes off, he has to reach for the food and then eat it. All right, so these are the type of trajectories that the animal is doing. And then, of course, at the same time, its brain activity has been collected from the motor cortex, and so our algorithms are going to match the brain activity exactly to the position of the three leaves. Maybe it's with this space. I'm just going to give you an idea of the difficulty of the task. Okay? So this is a set of 120 neurons in the motor cortex. Motor cortex is the motor system. It's not only motor cortex because of the motor cortex, because we also went to prefrontal cortex, you know, posterior parietal. So there are areas associated with. So there are areas associated with the motor system that we included in we placed the electrodes in these areas, in all these areas.
Visual?
Yes, not visual. This is motor, right? And so what we are interested in finding out areas that are that appear before the motor cortex. So this is gives you the goal of where the animal wants to move the hand. This is the implementation of the movement. And the posterior parietal is also very important because it's a place in the brain that kind of measures matches that matches a referential system that is the real world with the animal. So this is a very difficult thing, because when the brain has to plan how to get that thing, you know, you have to find out what is the distance between the body and that. These areas became very important. So this is neuroscience knowledge that we had to include in our to place the algorithms. But once we place the algorithms in these areas, this is what we get. This is time. Okay. This is each one of these dashes is color coded, and the color code tells you in 100 milliseconds how many spike charges they there were. And if you look at this, during this particular, you know, this is time, okay? So this is called a raster of firing rates. And what can you see? Some neurons are not related to the task, right? Because they don't fire, right? These guys practically don't fire. Other guys firing all the time. This is what goes on in the motor system when the animal is actually moving. So the question is, where is the information? Right? Because an algorithm will have to get this as an input, right? And then implement the particular movement that the animal was doing in 3D space. Where is the information? Right? And this other slide tells you where it's different. Because what we did, this is exactly the same raster that I showed you before in terms of spikes, but now I changed the resolution. And I color coded the spikes with the correlation with the x direction of the movement that the animal was doing. All right? So now, instead of telling you how many firings that particular neuron is doing, I'm calling that neuron for how correlated the spike firing is with the external signal. And as you can see, there is these vertical streaks, you know, that tell you exactly that are associated with correlation is really a way that we can exploit to effectively translate brain activity into the movements in 3D coordinates. Okay? So correlation is something that, you know, we know how to do, right? You guys, all of you know what is correlation, right? If I give you two signals X and Y, what is correlation between X and Y? Just, you know, expecting value of the product of the two variables, right? And so, or if you want to do this with the samples, is that just the sum of the products of x, y, and y, and y, right? And so, this means that the linear model could do this. And that was exactly the first implementation that we used. We used a simple linear model to perform this mapping from brain activity to movement. Of course, I told you that are rate models and spike models. So in the rate model, this is really very simple. You know, it's a linear, an adaptive linear model can do the operations. And that's exactly the one that we implemented for the first time in that microprocessor. Okay. But of course, we can also go non-linear. And so you start seeing here a lot of names that some of you may be familiar with, that these are neural networks, right, that are non-linear mappings. Is the linear mappings, the LMS winner was the one that I implemented, you know, and then we can use multiple models to improve performance, or we can use common filters or particle filters and so on. So you see that you have this many, many different types of algorithms. But you see, the point that I'm trying to make is that the reason why we selected this family of algorithms was because we understood where the information was. If you did not do this, it's the same thing as being blind in a room, you know, that you don't know. You are going to hit all the furniture that is in the room, right? But now this is a beacon. You say, okay, I know it's correlation, right? So you see, that is the insight that I think is important. And I'm not going to go into this detail. But the other thing that I thought it was interesting is once we have these models working, we could understand better and give this to the computational neuroscientists, you know, and we effectively could measure, and this was work done by Justin Sanchez, that now is the clinical director for biosciences. This guy has worked in my lab, I was his PhD supervisor, you know, and this was first published in the International of Biomedical Engineering in 2004. Because we were able to find that different parts of the cortex engage at different moments of the movement cycle. We could measure this by the electrodes that we have. Okay? And so this gives us really very a lot of interesting understanding of what are the sequence in time of that the brain has to go through when it plans and implements a movement. Okay? And if you are interested in this, this book that we wrote many years ago, I don't remember anymore, on brain machine interface engineering. Anyway, but so this was kind of the first generation, and the second, but we were not happy. Why were we not happy? Well, because I told you that I need to know the desired response, right? To build this model, right? You remember that block diagram with the red? I told you I need to know the desired response to train my decoder. What is the problem? The problem is that if you are working with a monkey that is able, we can have it. But how do you get this information if you want to apply this to a paraplegic that already cannot move? So if it cannot move, how can I train my decoder? Right? This is a difficulty. And of course, what we are still using for most part now, some of the work that you see in the literature, what you have to have a nurse that is moving in space for a certain movement, and then the nurse tells the patient, think that you are doing exactly the same movement that I'm doing. Okay? So the subject has to recreate thinking that he is doing the same thing as the external observer. And of course, we are not never certain that his thinking is the same, right? Okay, and when it starts, when it stops, there is very, very many uncertainties there. But this is the way that brain-machine interfaces and most of the work that you see in the literature, this is how it is done. And I thought that we can, engineers, improve it further. And so that's the reason why we start discussing symbiotic learning. Again, this was work done with Justin Sanchez in his PhD and the following student, Giovanna. So we went back to reinforcement learning. Reinforcement learning is a methodology that is associated with how we learn when we are kids, you know, and perhaps all throughout our lives when we learn a new task. We do this with reinforcement learning because we have self-motivated systems, and if I want to, you know, to grab that, you know, suppose that I had an accident, you know, and I could not control my arm anymore, you know, and then I have to relearn how to control the arm. And I do this using exactly this idea of perception action cycle. I look at what I want, you know, first time I do not do it right, second time I get it right, and so this changes exactly parallel to synaptic activity in the brain. Same thing as when you all learn how to ride a bike. First time, what happened? You fell, right? And then you try again, you fell again. At the point, you know what to do. So how does this happen? You are using your sensors, right? And your volunteer movements to find the proper equilibrium. This is what is exactly what goes on in the way that we learn how to do tasks, you know, with our body. Of course, this is automatic, so we don't think about it. But if you are a roboticist, you have to take this into consideration, right? And you have to write all the equations of motion. So the idea of reward learning is the idea of a dialogue between an agent and an environment. Okay? So the agent acts on the environment, and the environment provides to the agent, you know, things. Firstly, the state. Where is the state of the environment? How did it change? And also rewards. When you achieve what the goal, the agent should be rewarded. That means his algorithms can be changed. Okay. And so the reward learning is this closed loop cycle between an agent and its environment. And basically, what we would like to think is that the environment, you have positions in the environment and you have actions. And so what you have to discover is, for each position, what is the best action to receive the reward. Right? So this is how the system works. Of course, this can be mathematically put in equations. You know, this is really a Markov process. And we can use the theory of Markov processes to come up with these equations, you know. And what we used was not the theory, we used what we called the value function, that is a simplification of this same process, where we have a policy, and the policy is nothing but the expected value of the rewards, given that the agent is in a particular state and it does a particular action in that state. But there is reward as a problem, because it goes from k to 0 to infinity, so it's in the future. So how can we implement this reward in the future, right? And we cannot, right? We cannot know all the future, but we can do this. We can break this equation at the current and the next sample, the next prediction. So we can do this incrementally over time, right? Just predicting the current sample. And this is basically what we use in Q learning. I'm not going to get into a lot of details. But what happens in this new paradigm is that we don't need anymore information from where is the limb of the animal. Because now our learning algorithm as to dialogue with the brain of the rat, okay, and so this really means that in our gadget, you know, in the block diagram, I don't know, my environment now is composed of the robot and the rat, okay. So this is a not complicated thing, and what we were able to show is that effectively, we can train an agent. But this enables intelligent system design, okay? Because both systems adapt in closed loop, in a very tight coupling between brain activity and computer agents, okay? So it's kind of the computer algorithm is dialoguing, you know, with the brain through the signals that the brain is providing. Then they have to come up with a way of maximizing rewards. So with the rat, we maximize reward by giving the rat, you know, water. And of course, in the computer algorithm, when we reward the animal, we also have to reward the algorithm. So we give them 5 volts or something like that, you know, plus 5. Yeah, this is our reward in our algorithm. Because they had to match, they had to work. work together to solve this problem. Okay? I was going to show you a movie, but unfortunately I cannot do it because I'm sure that the movie did not. Let me see if I can. I'm just going to tell you what is the test that we did to train this rat. And this was done at just in Sanchez's lab at the Principe when he was there. All right, so the rat is in the cage, okay? The rat learns quickly that when an LED lights up in the cage, that if he wants to receive food here, he has to within, you know, I think it's 500 milliseconds, half a second, he has to go and press that lever. And he does this after 3 days. Okay? So it's very quick for him to do. But then we make the system much more complicated. So what did you do? So what we did is now we have the robot in the middle. So the animal still wants to receive food. But now, there is no, we retract this lever, so there is no lever in the cage anymore. However, we put, you know, we had a sequence of LEDs for the guy to see that there is outside the cage something that the robot needs to press. So when the robot presses, that switch, when the rat sees that light on, he will receive reward, the food. But you know, but the rat never saw the robot. The robot program had no information, right? So they both had to talk to each other, such that, you know, the robot, the computer algorithm that was in the robot arm would extract parts of the brain activity, right? Such that, because the computer algorithm also wanted to be rewarded, right? So both the animal and computer algorithm had to reward it, and they had to find out what is the best way to figure this out. See, but there is no desired response anymore. And this is, you know, a picture of the rat in the cage. And it turns out that the connection between the two was really a neural network. Okay, so brain activity of the animal will come here, and the output of the neural network were the actions of the robot. So there was an action that you would move left, another action you move right, up or down, and for one step or two steps. Okay, so basically the communication, these parameters here were trained under the reinforcement learning paradigm. And the animal, after being, you know, in this game for 2 weeks, was able to learn the task. Okay? And so we had a computer algorithm that was able to decode the information from the brain of the animal without providing any desired response. Okay, so this, I think, is really very important step in the history of brain machine interface. And this paper has been very, very well cited. Anyway, and this is the neural net. Now we have technology that does this much better. Right. So this is where, you know, our computer algorithms can do much better. But the first idea, we did not know if this was possible or not. And now we can do this with the current faster and without having local meaning, but then we probably can. All right, and unfortunately, I cannot show you the slide. If I take off my computer. All right, so I'm going to give you now the extension to somatosensory. So Right now, these examples that I gave you are motor. That means, yes, what I'm trying to do is decode the information created by the brain and, you know, and implement actions in an external computer or robot. But now I would like to close the loop. I also would like to be able to bring information from the real world, like, for instance, touch, and change them and give artificial to the brain, give the brain the ability to sense, you know, what the computer, what the robot is touching. And this is very important, right? Because if you, I'm sure that you probably know this, when I look at an object, I never know how heavy it is, right? And so, but when I try to lift it, I get that information. So that is proprioception. It comes from the sensory system to the brain. All right? And so, how can we do this? All right? So this is the idea of somatosensory BMI. Is how can we bring information to the brain that is conveyed by an external device that is not the body, right? So this is what really is this idea of somatosensory. And of course, if you want to do this, you cannot put electrodes in the motor cortex, right? Because motor cortex is the control of movement. So you have to stimulate other parts of the brain. And now you are going to inject current in the brain. Before, our electrodes were kind of passive, they were just collecting information from the brain. But now you need to inject current as if this injection of current is the information that comes from, let's say, you know, a finger when you touch it. You understand? So this is really the other part. And of course, if you want to do this, you have to put electrodes in sensory cortex. You know, in S1, the primary sensory cortex. So it's another part. But when we start looking at the spiking rates in sensory cortex, we found that sensory cortex is very sparse. All the neurons in sparse sensory cortex really spike very little. Okay? Very different from motor cortex. Motor cortex neurons are always firing, right? In sensory cortex, the spiking rates are very, very low. And so this brings a problem, you know, because if we have to use very long windows to see the variability of the sensations, and they are not, you know, we are measuring things that because the sensory system also is very impulsive in nature. It gives you information in a very, very small amount of time. Okay? So we thought that to solve this problem, we cannot use rates anymore. We have to go to tiny information. So our algorithms now have to be able to differentiate difference between spike events. In order to do this, we have to come up with, so this is an example of neural activity. Neural activity is just like this, you know, it's just spikes that occur in time. And the problem is we have to come up with ways of decoding information in multiple spike times, okay? And so it's a big problem because most of the times we will read zero, so you are going to have many, many dimensions, vectors with very long dimensions, and only a few ones appear in those events. And so this is not a very good mapping. And so what we decided to do is we decided to come up with a mapping from probability spaces to functional spaces, using this idea of the spike train as a realization of a point process, right? And so basically what this tells you is when I observe a certain spike a spike train, you think that this observation is associated with the probability law in time. And this probability law can be, in fact, described by the intensity function of a point process model. not going to get into the details, but the idea is that what we needed to do is quantify this probability law that exists in this space. But how can we do that? That is a big problem, okay? And of course, I can use Bayesian statistics that works with what is called the generalized linear model, but I don't think that this is a very good thesis. Because generalized linear models still work with these very long vectors, and so you need lots of data to be able to do a good job in training a generalized linear model. And so what we decided to do is go to a functional mapping in terms of voltaic expansions, and we, in particular, we implemented this on a reproducing kernel open space. That is a big name that I'm probably not many of you have heard. This reproducing kernel open space are functional spaces that have a linear structure. And so what we did is we mapped spike trains to these probability spaces, very much like those of you that know support vector machines. Support vector machines also do a mapping of the input space to the reproducing kernel open space. I don't know how many of you know support vector machines, but it's kind of a machine learning technique that is very well known. But we are doing now this for time functions, you know, so this is a little complicated. I'm not going to get into this, but we came up with a way of doing this mapping. And it turns out that this is the kernel that we use to map spike trains into a reproducing kernel open space. It's also an exponential. Normally use a Gaussian function. This looks like a Gaussian, but there's a Gaussian over intensity rates in time. Okay, but we were able to come up with the multi-channel, and this is another book that I wrote many in 2010 about doing filters in this reproducing kernel open spaces. And the beautiful thing about this reproducing kernel open space. Once I have data mapped there, I can use the algorithm that I use in communication systems. I can use the same algorithm. Okay? So this is a beautiful thing. So the big problem about going from spikes to any data when you use a reproducing kernel open space is how do you design the kernel? And in our case, we design kernels in time that were quantifying differences in the intensity. And so we could use basically the same algorithm. So I'm not going to get into details of how this is done, but I'm going to just give you the idea of the task that we used. This is basically the task. So we did this data with Joe Francis from Stony Brook. No, he was, I don't know where he was, but I think it was in New York, yeah. And so turns out that when you touch, when you press your finger, the body has a space map of your body. So when you touch the finger, it turns out that this goes to a particular part of the thalamus. Thalamus is a central relay in the brain. And if you touch the finger, this is the part of the thalamus that lights up. If you touch your head, there's an upper part of the thalamus that lights up. So you see, with this mapping, then the S1, the general, you know, the sensory cortex is able to know, is able to find out what part of the body is being sensed, right? Because this is a mapping that the system developed itself. See, so this is how the brain, you know, when you are cooking and you put your finger in the stove, you know, you don't take the food, right? You go and take the hand where you are. And that's exactly how the brain knows it. So there is a very nice mapping between the brain and body that is really this wiring. So if I want to come up with a system that is going to affect the sensory cortex, we thought that the best way of doing is to inject current in the, you know, in VPL, in fact, in the part of the thalamus. VPL is a part of the thalamus that does this mapping. There is And so the idea is we place an array of electrodes on the thalamus, and we would inject current, okay, such that the animal felt that something is was happening in his hand. The current exactly in that particular part of the that which was in hand. You know, so this is nice. Why? Because I can collect data through the body, so I know that when the finger of the animal was pressed, you know, what is the spike train that appeared in the cortex, right, in sensory, in S1. And so what I can do is I can stimulate the thalamus artificially, and this is going to provide some other spike train, and what I want is to make this spike train look as much as possible as the previous one, right? So if I can achieve this, then I've solved the problem, right? Because the animal is going to feel like being touched when I'm injecting the current. Okay. So this is really what we had to do. But in order to do that, we had to do this working with the structure of the spike. Cannot use rate, but because you only have about 20 spikes for each touch. Okay. So this is the reason why we have to go through this trouble of designing systems with spike trains. You know, so we use an adaptive burst control mechanism that is supervised, but this is exactly the one we use. So basically, let me tell you what this is. So the spike train that I collect from the through the body, the green spike train, I put this at the input of the control. And then this plant is exactly the communication between the thalamus and S1. And so I'm measuring the output of S1. And so what I like to do is to make this output that I measure in S1 when I stimulate my electrodes, I like to make this signal as close as possible as that signal. And so I create here a feedback, closed loop feedback. And so this controller really has to lead to the optimal controller inverts this plant such that I have a transfer function of 1 between the input and output. Okay? So this is the basic idea of adaptive control. And we have to do this in the spike domain. Okay, so this was took one PhD and many weeks to do it, but we were successful. In 2011, we presented the first result. I'm not going to get into a lot of details because they are a little heavy in the math. But you know, you see that there are lots of feedbacks that you have to do because we have to first come up with a model of this transfer function, and then we have to invert it through this control, right? Because I don't know the equations for this transfer function. So I have to evaluate it from real data, right, with this plant model. Anyway, so this was done, and I'm not going to go into details of this, but it worked pretty well. And this was published. I'm also going to have many other stuff that I'm not going to talk about that. Because now we have multi-scale kernels, you know, both LFPs and spikes. I'm just going to kind of conclude and give you some comments. All right. So, proof of concept. I think it's established. We now know enough about how the brain is organized. And we have the technology, both in terms of electrode arrays and in terms of computer algorithms, machine learning algorithms, to implement this. But we have to remember that the communication that we are establishing with the brain is really very low rate. So we estimate that if I, you know, in BCIs that use basically electrode arrays placed on the scalp, non-invasively, we have about 25 bits per minute of bandwidth. So 25 bits per minute means that you have less than 2 bits. That 0.0 bit per second, right? So you can't basically transfer a lot of information. Right? This is one of the difficulties that we still have today in terms of brain machine interface. And of course, if I go in invasively, that means if I put placing electrodes inside brain tissue, you know, this number of bits increases, you know, tenfold almost. But it's still very low. So the question that we are faced now, and the question that you probably have to solve in your generation, is how do you improve this? How do you improve this? How do we go, you know, can I multiply this number by 1,000? Because if I can multiply this number by 1,000, there is many more information that I'm exchanging with the brain. This means that he can do many more things, right? When with the robot assistant, you understand? So this really is where we are now, is that we have proof of concept, but we still need to find out how to increase this channel bandwidth. And if you ask to my dear friends neuroscientists, they say, oh, increase the number of electrons, right? Because they are right. Because the brain is a distributed system. Each part of the brain is doing its own thing. So if I really want to have a better way of extracting information or communicating with the brain, I have to place electrodes in many different brain areas. But this becomes, you know, very difficult to be approved by FDA and other agencies, you know, and I don't think that this is a good way. You know, I think we engineers, we have to rethink our architecture. Right? Because right now I'm talking about decoding and encoding, you know, but these are very, you know, specific. I would like to create a computer that is able to talk to the brain in the same way that you talk to your dog. When you talk to your dog, you give him a hint and the guy understands perfectly. Right? So this is the thing. One bit of information, and the dog, boom, that's what you want, most of the time. Right? So this is what I think we need. We need to elevate our computer architectures to the point that they mimic much better what goes on in the brain, such that the brain just then communicates at a very high level with our computer architecture. So I think this is the design problem for computer engineers and for, you know, machine learning scientists. Okay? And you still don't know how to do it. Right? So there's a lot of work to be done in this area. Very exciting. Okay? All right. So I think this is where I would like to kind of conclude my presentation. I went a little overboard, but I think I wanted to give you a perspective both for the newcomer and also for the ones that have much more knowledge. Thank you very much for your attention. I think we have time for
10 minutes for questions.
Yes.
Yeah. 10 minutes for questions.
All right. Yes. It's not only from one mouse to the other, you know, it's from one day of the same mouse to the next day, you know, the variability is very high, you know, and the sources of variability are several, right? First is the electrodes, right? So we think that we are, you know, measuring the information from the same neurons, right? From day one to day two. May not, right? Because the array may have moved. Rats, you know, they try to take off the rays and things like that. So there are variability that comes from the effectively data collection stage, right? And that I think is the major source of variability. Is exactly we are not doing this yet with enough precision to guarantee that we are collecting information.
same neurons. And so what this means, you know, is that this method of reinforcement learning, the algorithm is always learning. So if something changes from day one to day two, right, the algorithm will also change. You understand? So this gives us some hope that this symbiotic BMIs will get, you know, more robust, because right now they are not. Right? So this is one of the difficulties. The other difficulty, you know, is that, you know, the person, also the brain of the person changes, or the animal changes, you know. Our brains are not doing always the same thing. And again, if you have a fixed algorithm, and so when I was working with Dr. Nicolelli's lab, you know, they had to train the animal, the algorithm for the animal every day in the morning. Okay, so when they start doing the experimentation, the first phase of data collection was to train the algorithm, to update the algorithm, right, for the conditions of that particular day. Right? And so this is robustness and repeatability problem that these systems also have. But the thing is that if you have enough neurons, the organization of the motor cortex, local organization of the motor, also changes. Okay, so you end up, when we did this analysis, you know, that the brain, the tuning curves of the neurons in motor cortex change drastically from day one to day 10, you know, and in day 10, you know, there were only a few neurons that basically were driving the performance, while in the beginning the performance was all, you know, was a composition of contributions from many neurons. So there's plasticity in the motor cortex that you can really measure through this analysis. So there is hope that really, you know, if the system is able to adapt to the signals that are obtained, you know, and every day, that this can be controlled. But it's still a big problem.
Okay.
Yes.
Is the theory developed enough so that you're able to see interference of spike trains? What I have in mind is, in quantum physics, you observe one thing, it could interfere another observation. So, but it seems to me that you have to get your timing down so that your channels are broader.
Yes.
Before you see that, but I'm asking, have you seen anything like that?
I mean, we see reorganization, right? So that means what we see is the part of the neural tissue that is near the electrodes, their function, you know, is modified by the use of the interface. So, but it's not an interference phenomenon; it's more of a reorganization phenomenon. But it may be also interference, in some sense, right? But that is the.
Can you see your probabilities have changed?
Changed. Oh yeah.
Did I talk to you for 10 minutes after the talk?
Okay, sure. Yeah, I mean, but this is what happens. The probability changes.
And
yes.
To maybe build on that interesting question, that at least, you know, as I teach here in neuroscience, we know that the changes in the brain at the biochemical level can happen within seconds, meaning neurotransmitters release.
Yeah.
Receptors being up or down regulated, that takes minutes to hours. Genes being changed, that can take days, weeks, or lifetimes. That physical change, right? Rewiring of the actual brain takes physical time. And of course, we have this burst in adolescence, and then as we age, we just work with what we have, we try to keep what we have. So it's you're changing the system
changing
by looking at it.
Exactly. This is exactly that. Every time you use a part of the brain changes. If you learn something, brain changes. Yeah. It's really the main. Exactly, that's exactly it. Yeah. So this is the physical embodiments that you see. More questions from the end crowd. Come on. All right.
Do you have the same kind of reorganization problems in, say, the spinal cord or like the periphery? periphery nervous system, or are they a little more stable?
Okay, so the spinal cord is much more complicated. So when you go to, there are some reorganization going on, but the peripheral nervous system is very different from the central nervous system, right? Because the peripheral nervous system, you have the functions very well defined on the you know, from the spinal cord, right? So when you a neuron that is a long axon, you know, this neuron only is connected to a pool of other neurons, right? And so it's much more difficult to reorganize the functions in the spinal cord, right? But there are some reorganization, okay, that exists even in people that are, you know, quasi paralytic, you know. So that means that they have very few connections, you know, left from the brain to the spinal cord. But this is also, I mean, there are many other opportunities in the peripheral nervous system, you know, because the information is already decoded in, you know, in trunks, let's say, because a motor neuron is going to be connected to a particular muscle, right? So the idea there would be, can I stimulate the muscle, right? And so this is the same idea that I showed in the sensory, right? That we will do stimulation at the right motor pools, you know, that can contract a certain muscle, right? So the problem, but the two systems are very different. You know, I'm not a neuroscientist, and I'm sure that you can add on to my points, you know, but I think that the central nervous system, you have this massive interconnectivity that can change. But when you go to the periphery, it's a much more stable system.
Any more questions?
Yes.
When you're talking about spike timing, are you looking at any particular frequency in the EEG, or is it in the whole spectrum?
This is not EEG. Okay. This is neural level. You know, the spike timing that I'm talking here, because you may think in the EEG you also have spikes in the normal conditions when you have epileptic seizures and things like that, right? But where you're talking is each neuron, when it communicates to it's an action potential. Right? My when I call them spikes, they're action potentials, they're not epileptic spikes, right? But besides this, what was the question?
I was asking about the frequency.
Because it's not frequency. You know, as I said, you know, there's rate is frequency, mm-hmm. right? So there is some information in at the rate level, but I think that when you many parts of the brain, you know, they don't communicate with enough spikes, you know, because the system, you can imagine that every time that the neuron spikes, that energy that is being used, right? So the system is to conserve energy, you really have a very, very tightly controlled spike rates. And some parts of the brain, the spike rates are very low, right? Other parts are more active, okay? And so in the motor cortex, we are able to come up with good interfaces using the rate. But if you go to sensory, it's very different.
So where is the EEG coming into place in the brain mass interfaces?
I'm not so sure that, that's, first of all, you can't just use EEG, right? Because what I call BCI, brain-computer interfaces, they use external electrodes only. You know, the brain is a complex system with multiple scales, and the information that you obtain depends on the scale that you are collecting today, right? And so the EEG is the same, is a field, right? It's a field. And what we are talking here is these action potentials are elemental, you know, so that the communication between neurons, right? I believe myself it's possible to combine the two. In fact, I skipped some slides where I already have shown. shown that we can use local field potential and spikes together, and our results improve. Okay? So that means that, and what is the local field potential? Local field potential is kind of the EEG of that particular part of the brain. Because the brain is an heterogeneous system, you know, so when you go to level 5, let's say the cortex, there is a field that is basically built from ionic currents around layer 5. Right? And if you put the electron in layer 1, you should probably use it. So basically, you know, the EEG that we measure in the, on the scalp is basically, you know, pyramidal cells, you know, that define the pyramidal cells. Is how can we bring extra information? So local field potentials are extra information that we are using besides the action potentials between, you know, neural fibers.
Maybe I was thinking of, you know, high brain functions like depression.
Well, I mean, my point is that you don't see depression at the neural level. If I measure information from a particular brain, from a, you know, even if it is in the middle or in very critical areas of depression and things like that, you know, I probably cannot distinguish.
So maybe EEG more useful there.
I think the EEG translates cognition. While, you know, if I want to translate cognition at the neural level, I will have to have a tremendous amount of electrodes at different parts of the brain and come up with that, you know, reconstruct part of that information that the EEG might be.
I think we should leave it here because people have scheduled up to 2 o'clock.
Okay. All right.
Thank you very much, Dr. Principe, for coming. Do you have any more questions? Down here. Time for that.
I need your fresh.